It's my pleasure and my great honor to welcome my beloved wife, Pastor Kate, to bring the word of the Lord to us. Amen. Welcome.
Amen. Praise the name of the Lord. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Amen, amen, amen. We thank God again for another time that the Lord has given us to come into the presence of the Lord. We don't take it for granted. We thank God because he has been with each one of us and protected us throughout that whole week. And I know every one of you is experiencing the goodness of God wherever they are. Can see our snow out through our windows. And we thank God. This is unusual in Texas. our sister Fine and brother Sam, for us, we are celebrating to see what God is doing this side. So otherwise, we want to thank God. We want to go back to the book of Ezra chapter 4. But I want to ask you, let's just open up our hearts to receive what the Lord has for us. Why don't we just take a minute to pray? Mighty and everlasting Father, we bless you. We honor you. We give you the praise for this time that you've given us, oh God. Father, we thank you for a time of worship that we had and a time of just coming into your presence, oh God. And even as we sit to listen and to hear your word, Holy Spirit of God, we ask you to come and minister to us. We ask you to come and fill us afresh. We ask you to come and quicken us, oh God of glory. Father, we cover ourselves in the blood of Jesus. We arrest every one of our thoughts and we bring them to the obedience of our Lord Jesus Christ. Come and touch us, oh God. We speak wisdom and insight and revelation, oh God. I release myself before you in the name of Jesus Christ. But Lord, you shall use me as your mouthpiece, oh God, to declare what you want to say, even in this time, in the name of Jesus. We bless you, Lord. We worship you and we welcome you, Jesus. We welcome you, Holy Spirit of God. We welcome you, Abba Father. In Jesus' name do we pray and believe. Amen and amen. Amen. So we want to thank God again for this time that the Lord has given us. And nowhere in the book, we started off in the book of Ezra, chapter 1. And I remember, if everyone can remember, we're reading about rebuilding the altars and rebuilding even the temple or rebuilding our foundations. Praise the name of the Lord. And we just want to continue even from there. And today we're going to look at the opposition that comes as we go into building. The enemy does not like it when we start off, when we purpose to rebuild, when we put our minds into doing the will of God, there is opposition. And I was so amazed that the part of opposition in the book of Ezra actually comes in the book of Ezra chapter 4. And we also know in the book of Nehemiah, we see opposition in the book of Nehemiah chapter 4. Praise the name of the Lord. Just when they had started, just when they were building, there was the enemy who was not happy about it. And if we read from the book of Ezra chapter 4, the Bible says that from verse 1, it says, when the enemies of Judah and Benjamin heard that the exiles were building a temple for the Lord, the God of Israel, they came to Zerubbabel and to the ends of the and to the heads of the families and say, let us help you build, because like you, we seek your God and have been sacrificing to him since the time of Esarhaddon, king of Assyria, who brought us here. So we see when the enemies had, and then the Bible says that when they heard what the people of Judah and Benjamin were doing, the Bible says that they rose up in opposition. And we see that also in the Bible, in the book of Nehemiah, chapter 4, verse 1, it says that now when Sambalat heard that we are building the wall, he was angry and greatly enraged, and he jeered at the Jews. So there was so much opposition then in Nehemiah. Just as we see, there was so much opposition because the people had purpose to do the will of God. The people had purpose to build. Praise the name of the Lord. So in the same way, as I said, when we purpose to build, let us know that we are actually engaging in warfare. Let us know that the enemy is opposed to our building, but we have to keep on going. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible says that they came to Zerubbabel and the heads of the family, and they came and they told them, let us help you, because like you, we seek your God
and have been sacrificing to him since the time of Esarhaddon, or the king of Assyria. So they came with deception. Praise the name of the Lord. They came with deception. That is why it's good to know who your God is and to know your stand with God. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible says that, but Zerubbabel in chapter 3, verse 3, it says, but Zerubbabel and Joshua and their heads and the rest of the heads of the families of Israel, they answered, you have no part with us in building a temple to our God. We alone will build it for the Lord, the God of Israel, as King Cyrus, the king of Persia, commanded us. So they knew their stand. And they recognized the deception that was with these people. They recognized that these were their enemies. It is good to know who our enemies are. It's good to know that the purposes of the enemy is to kill and to destroy and to bring down what we have started, what we want to do for the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. That is why it's good to arm ourselves and even to know that they also know who we are in the Lord. And then in verse 4, it says, I'll just read as we continue. It says, but then the people around them set out to discourage the people of Judah and make them afraid to go on building. They bribed officials to work against them and frustrate their plans during the entire reign of Cyrus, king of Persia, and down to the reign of Darius, king of Persia. Can you imagine that the people, the Bible says that the people around them, so the warfare was not only in the people who are in the high places. The warfare was not only in the heads of the, as the Bible says, that where does that say, the enemies of Judah. It was not only in the leaders that were up there, but the Bible says that the people around them. So there was warfare all over, coming from the high place, coming down to all those that were around them. And the Bible says that they used the spirit of discouragement. They made them to fear. They made them, the Bible says that they bribed the officials to work against them, to frustrate their plans during the entire reign of Cyrus. They did not do that for one day, but the Bible says that they did that for an entire reign. From the time they were told to go and build, from the entire reign of King Cyrus, to the entire up to the reign of Darius. And I was looking at it and I was seeing, I was wondering, was there another king in between Cyrus and Darius? And the Bible says that there is another king. I just didn't put him down. There was also another king that came in between, and he reigned and he left and he died, and Darius took over. So the warfare was strong. The warfare was, there was so much warfare on them. Just because they decided to build the altar, just because they decided to lay the foundation of the temple, praise the name of the Lord. So we should know that the enemy comes with discouragement, and he comes to make you fear. Because I believe by causing them to fear was that fear can be very tormenting, you know. And these are the strategies that the enemy uses. And the enemy came with frustration, with an intention. The intention of the enemy was to cause weariness. When the enemy attacks you with discouragement, when the enemy attacks you with fear, when the enemy attacks you, so you see, it's a lineup of attacks from the enemy. The purpose of the enemy is to cause you to get weary. You know, we can be weary when we are battling, and especially when we are battling alone. Praise the name of the Lord. We can become weary. And when we become weary, we lose our purpose. We actually forget what we intended to do, what was our purpose in the very beginning. Because you can imagine, if that warfare took that long, I mean, for sure, they could have lost their hope in between. That was a lot of warfare. Praise the name of the Lord. That was a lot of discouragement for a long time. I don't know what you've been worrying for a very long time, but the Lord wants you to strengthen yourself. Praise the name of the Lord. And know that he is in your midst. Praise the name of the Lord. And know that he's the God that fights our battles. He's a God of breakthrough. He's a God that comes to our aid. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible says that their intention was actually to cause weariness, and their intention was also to abort the purpose of God. the enemy's attention, the enemy's purpose to bring you down and to distract you from what God wants to do in your life is so that you may be, you'll be so wary, get distracted, and the purpose and what God has called you to do to get, you know, to get aborted. But that is not the will of God. God wants us to ready ourselves and to wage a good warfare. Praise the name of the Lord. You know, when we start, if you read from the book of Nehemiah, I mean, from the book of Ezra, in the very beginning, the first verse, the Bible says that it starts by saying, in the first year of Cyrus, king of Persia, in order to fulfill the word of the Lord spoken by Jeremiah, the Lord moved the heart of Cyrus, king of Persia, to make a proclamation throughout his realm and also to put it in writing. Let me tell you, when sometimes, and I know we've heard it so many times, when God comes in, when somebody gives you a word of knowledge, because this is a prophetic word that came forth. This was a fulfillment of a word that God had spoken way down. Praise the name of the Lord. God had spoken about it. God had spoken. And actually he had mentioned that Cyrus was going to build him a temple. Praise the name of the Lord. When Cyrus did not know anything about it, when Cyrus did not know even who God is, the Bible says, and there's a reason I'm going all the way back, in the book of Isaiah chapter 44 verse 28, it says that who says to Cyrus, he is my shepherd and will accomplish all that I please. And he will say of Jerusalem, let it be built, and of the temple, let its foundation be laid. So this had been prophesied way, way, way back in the book of Isaiah. It is something, it is the word of God that had been declared a long time. But the time had come and God was bringing his word to come. Praise the name of the Lord. How many of you know that once the word of God is proclaimed, every time the word of God comes, and in the time of fulfillment, you remember the time of Jesus, Jesus' birth was proclaimed a long time ago. But even when the word of God came to be and it came to pass, that we know that there was a king who rose up against this word, and he wanted to kill all the boys. He wanted to bring to naught the purposes of the enemy. This, in the same way, this is what the enemy wanted to do. He wanted to sabotage the plans of God. He wanted to sabotage what God had spoken. Praise the name of the Lord. And that is why it is so good for us. In accordance, if I can get that scripture, in the book of Timothy, the book of Timothy says about waging a good warfare. If Miss Lorraine, if you get that before me, that would be good. But the Bible talks about waging a good warfare when we receive the word of God. And many times when we receive a prophetic word, we sit on it. You know, we think that it is just going to come to pass. But the Bible says when this word is declared, you know, we know as the Bible says, if I can get that, it says actually in 1 Timothy chapter 1 verse 18, it says that this charge I commit to you, son Timothy, according to the prophecies previously made concerning you, that by them you may wage the good warfare. Praise the name of the Lord. Paul told Timothy, the word of God, the prophecy has been spoken according to the prophecies that previously were made concerning you. You know, because he found Timothy, prophecies that had been spoken to him, most probably he found Timothy sitting down and waiting for the prophetic words to come through. But Paul talks to Timothy and he says, concerning the prophecies that were made to you, previously made concerning you, by them wage a good warfare. It means that you take hold of the word of God. If God has told you that you're going to get healed, if God has told you that he's going to bless you, you take hold of the prophetic word of God and you stand with it and you bring it even as you pray and you tell the Lord, Lord, you spoke and you fight a good warfare. Praise the name of the Lord. Because the enemy's purpose is to steal, to kill, and to destroy. And that is why when the word of God was spoken, praise the name of the Lord, it just takes you to speak the word. When the word of God was spoken, because when Cyrus spoke, he did not speak to a small group, but the Bible says that he spoke in order to fulfill the word. He spoke to the whole of Persia. He made a proclamation throughout his realm. And he also put it in writing. Praise the name of the Lord. And thank God he put it in writing, because we shall see the reason why it was good that he did that. But once he proclaimed it, all the enemies were on their toes. And they realized that this was going to happen. And now when they saw that, and then they saw people coming to work, They went ahead and started opposing the work of God through discouragement, through fear, through frustration, in the intention of causing weariness and aborting the purposes of God. So I encourage you, whatever the Lord has spoken to you, whatever the Lord has said is going to do in your life, even it may not have been a prophetic word, maybe it is a word that God has spoken to you through his word. The word of God is his prophecy. Praise the name of the Lord. The prophetic word of God is Jesus himself. Praise the name of the Lord. He speaks to us in different ways. Whatever the Lord has spoken to you in that word, take hold of the word of God and fight and wage a good warfare with it. And God is going to see you through. Praise the name of the Lord. The Bible says that even as we continue, that in verse 6 it says that at the beginning of the reign of Xerxes, that's in we are back to Ezra chapter 3, verse 6. It says, at the beginning of the reign of Xerxes, they lodged an accusation against the people of Judah and Jerusalem. See, the warfare is coming in different levels. Praise the name of the Lord. They started by discouragement. Then they started by causing, then they caused fear. And then they went ahead and they started trying to frustrate the word of God and the work of God by bribing the officials. And then they take it to another level. And they said, during the time of Xerxes, praise the name of the Lord, during the time of King Xerxes, during the time of Antiochus, the Bible says that they lodged an accusation. And then they started writing these letters. Praise the name of the Lord. In verse 7, we see one of these letters. It says that in the days of Antaxerxes, king of Persia, Bishlam, Mithredath, it says, and Tabel, and the rest of his associates, they wrote a letter to Antaxerxes. The letter was written in Aramaic script and in the Aramaic language. If you have your Bible, just follow up with me. And then it says that Rehum, the commanding officer, and Shimshai, the secretary, wrote a letter against Jerusalem. They started writing letters against Jerusalem, and they started writing to King Antiochus. Remember that we started with King Cyrus, and then it went to King Xerxes. And then now we are in a different king, meaning that it has progressed on for so long. Really, it has progressed on. The enemy will try aborting the purposes of God at every level so that you cannot walk in the will of God. But when God's word comes forth, believe me, God will bring it to pass. No matter how long it shall come to pass, no matter what kind of opposition that the enemy brings, God will fight our battles for us. Praise the name of the Lord. But we have to stand with the word of God and not get discouraged and not allow the enemy to bring us down. The Bible says in verse 9 that Rehum, the commanding officer, and Shimshai, let me just go to the letter in verse 11. It says to King Antaxerxes, it says, from your servants, the Trans-Euphrates, the king should know that the people who came up to us from you have gone to Jerusalem and are rebuilding that rebellious and wicked city. They are restoring the walls and repairing the foundations. You see the reason why they were coming against them? It is written on the letter. It says the reason they are restoring the walls, they are repairing the foundations. Praise the name of the Lord. And then in 13 it says, furthermore, the king should know that if this city is built and its walls are restored, no more taxes, tribute, or duty will be paid, and eventually the royal revenues will suffer. Do you see what the enemy sees? Sometimes we go through battle, we forget that we are more than conquerors. Forget the strategy. It's good to know the strategies of the enemy. See, they came in the letter and they say, these guys, and they call them, they're building this wicked city. Jerusalem was not a wicked city. Jerusalem had been built up. The temple had been built up in the days of Solomon. And we know that the blessing of God was on the temple. And the reason why they came back is because God had commissioned it. But you see, had appointed it for them to go in. But see what they tell the king. They say that if this city is rebuilt, if though you're able to bring your foundations, If how but you build your foundations, then the Bible says that no more taxes or tribute or duty will be paid, and eventually the royal revenues will suffer. What do I mean? That when the walls are restored, the satanic bondages, personal and generations, will be broken. Praise the name of the Lord. The enemy knows that. When you lay the foundation, when you build your altar, when you put things into place, then those things, because we saw in the Bible that God has called us the builders of foundations, the builders of age-old foundation. As long as these foundations are not built up, then they are satanic strongholds. Praise the name of the Lord. They are satanic bondages, you know, personal and generationally. But immediately we rise up to build those walls, you know, those things are broken. Praise the name of the Lord. And that is why he said, if these walls are restored, then we are in trouble. If these walls are restored, whatever I was getting from Albert, whatever I was getting from Move, whatever bondage that I put into him, now he will be a free person. Praise the name of the Lord. That is why it is good to be, to know who we are. That is, it is good for us to rise up and know that what the strategies of the enemy are. The Bible says that the weapons of our warfare are not carnal, and neither do we wage war against flesh and blood, but against principalities and powers and rulers and even evil forces in the high places. And these evil forces are against your destiny. He knows that when your walls are rebelled, the walls of your family will be rebelled. The walls of your generation will be rebelled. The enemy looks generationally. Praise the name of the Lord. When we are looking at things just right here and what we are going through, praise the name of the Lord, we can miss out on what God wants to do. When we build them, we are not only building them for ourselves. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible says, you know, and I put a note here that says the enemy wants to keep God's people under bondage, oppression, under bondage and oppression. And he knows that once you're set free, his kingdom will suffer loss. Praise the name of the Lord. And that is why they say eventually the royal revenues will suffer, because now they will not be able to get what they're getting from the children of Israel. Praise the name of the Lord. But we thank God because we are more than conquerors in Christ. And the Bible says in verse 14, now since we are under obligation to the palace and it is not proper for us to see the king dishonored, I'm still reading the letter, we are sending this message to inform the king so that as such may be made in the archives of your predecessors. In these records, you will find that this city is a rebellious city, troublesome to kings and provinces, a place with a long history of sedition. That is why this city was destroyed. And we see an evil report. Praise the name of the Lord. The enemy has got an evil report against you. The Bible says in Colossians chapter 2, verse 13, verse 15, actually, it says, let me just read it all. It says, when you were dead in your sins and in the uncircumcision of your flesh, God made you alive with Christ. He forgave us all our sins, having canceled the charge of legal indebtedness, which stood against you and condemned you. He has taken it away, nailing it to the cross, and he has disarmed the powers and authorities, making them a public spectacle. What am I talking about? The enemy has had a charge and of legal indebtedness charged against you. The Bible says that, you know, the enemy comes, he's a what? He comes to, you know, he stands before God. There's a word that I'm trying to look for, but I'm going to get to that. But the enemy is an accuser. He's an accuser of brethren. That is the word. And the enemy was accusing them, saying, this is a rebellious city. This city it is the way it is because there was a long history of sedition. Know that the enemy will try to put you in the place, to keep you in the place where you are, in condemnation, praise the name of the Lord, in fault finding, so that you look back and you just see that the wrong things that you have done. He was bringing, you know, speaking of condemnation. And the Bible says that, you know, that let's just continue in that. So the enemy, is good to know the strategies of the enemy against us. And I just want to continue in 16. It says, we inform the king that if this city is built and its walls are restored, you will be left with nothing in the Trans-Euphrates. Can you imagine? That is what he said. It says, it began by saying, you know, if this city is rebelled, you'll have nothing. Let me just read a section of what I read in verse 14. It says that, you know, the kings and the provinces, maybe as we read, we shall read what the king wrote and we shall understand better. But you see what they say, that if this city is rebelled, just like we have seen before, then we are not going to have anything. The enemy knows that if you build your walls, the enemy knows that when you get into right standing with God, the enemy knows that when you put your things in order, the enemy knows that when you build your foundation, then there is a loss for him. But I thank God, because we are more than conquerors in Christ, we have to take our position. Praise the name of the Lord. Your freedom and your deliverance is a threat to your enemy. Again, your freedom and your deliverance is a threat to the enemy. That is why we have to persist. That is why we have to fight. That is why we cannot let go. That is why we cannot give up no matter what. That is why we cannot look at our situation and camp there and say, this is it. This is what God intended to have. That is why we cannot look at our children and see maybe the way that they're going and declare, this is it for them. That is why we need to take up and rise up to the occasion, not only in our families, even in this nation. We have to rise up to the occasion, because the enemy knows that your freedom, the freedom of your children, the freedom in this nation is a threat to the enemy. Praise the name of the Lord, because he comes to steal, to kill, and to destroy. Let us read the reply of the king. Praise the name of the Lord. The Bible wrote this, the king wrote this reply in 18. He says, the letter that you sent us has been read and translated in my presence. I issued an order, and a search was made, and it was found that this city has a long history of revolt against kings and has been a place of rebellion and sedition. Jerusalem has had powerful kings ruling over the whole of Trans-Euphrates, and taxes and tribute and duty were paid to them. Praise the name of the Lord. Then he says, now issue an order to this man to stop working, so that this city will not be rebuilt until I order. That is what the king said. And then he said, be careful not to neglect this matter. Why let this threat grow to the detriment of the royal interests? Praise the name of the Lord. The enemy saw what was there. Praise the Lord. And if we read, just go through that letter a little, it says that when they looked through, they saw that Jerusalem had powerful kings ruling over the whole of Trans-Euphrates. Do you know who is speaking right now? It is the king of the Trans-Euphrates. He knows the power. He knows the authority. He knows who the kings of this, who Jerusalem was. He knows who the people of Israel, who the people of Israel are. He knows about their records of the powerful kings ruling over Trans-Euphrates. And they know that all the taxes that they have been getting from the people, from the children of Israel, they themselves were the ones who are paying. See, the enemy knows who you are. The enemy knows your authority. The enemy knows your power. The enemy knows who stands with you. The enemy knows what you can do to destroy his kingdom. Praise the name of the Lord. The enemy knows that if you take your position, then everything is not going to be the same. He knows, and he knew that the kings were actually ruling over them at that particular time. But now, because of the sin of the children of Israel, everything had been turned around. And immediately he got the letter. The Bible said that he issued a command, and he told those people that were writing the letter to against the children of Israel, he told them, go tell those people to stop that work. Tell them so that this city will not be rebuilt until I order it. And he made sure, he said, be careful not to neglect this matter. Why let this threat grow to the detriment of our royal interests? Praise the name of the Lord. Why let this building continue? Because he knew that once everything has been put together, then they're going, that the kingdom, his kingdom, was going to be in trouble. That the children of Israel would rise up and they'll take their position. They would rise up. And not only that, they knew that once the altar had been brought up, once the temple had been built, then sacrifices would be offered to God. And this would be a place that was holy and that was given to God. Praise the name of the Lord. He wanted to stop their advancing of the work of God. Praise the name of the Lord. But you know what? You know, let us see what happened. I hope I'm not going too quick. And the Bible says in verse 23 that as soon as the copy of the letter of King Artaxerxes was read to Rehum and Shimshai, the Bible says that they went immediately to the Jews in Jerusalem and they compelled them by force to stop. Imagine, that's what they did. Immediately they got the letter from the king. They now had the authority. They went to the Jews in Jerusalem and they compelled them by force to stop. And so we see this, and the Bible says in verse 24, that that's the work of the house of God in Jerusalem. It came to a standstill until the second year of the reign of Darius, king of Persia. So they were able to bring the working and what the Jews were doing, they brought it to an end because of the letters that had been sent, because of the letter that the king had actually written. So the enemy had looked like he had fulfilled his plans. The enemy may look like he's come to you, that he's brought everything down, like there's nothing that is going to be rebuilt. And you can imagine what happened. The children of Israel, and this work did not stop for a short time. The Bible says that it stopped for a long time until King Darius came into place, and he came into place and was ruling for 2 years. The temple had been stopped. They had stopped rebuilding the temple. They had stopped doing what they were supposed to do, and they fell and they became complacent. And this is what the enemy wants to do. Whenever the enemy stops you from doing what the Lord has called you to do, and I've written a note for myself, it said between that time, the children of God became distracted and they lost their vision and their zeal for building. They forgot why God told them to come to Jerusalem. And we're going to see why. The enemy having planned, the reason, the moment that they were stopped from building, the moment that they ceased doing what they did, you know, and everything quietened down. You know, we do not see any more fighting. We do not see any more opposing, because the enemy thought that he had gotten hold of the children of Israel. And we see that when we go on, we see that everything stood still. And the Bible says, if we can just go back in chapter 5 real quick. The Bible says in Ezra chapter 5, that now Haggai, the prophet, and Zechariah, the prophet, a descendant of Edo, prophesied to the Jews in Judah and Jerusalem in the name of God, of the God of Israel, who was over them. Then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, and Joshua, son of Jozadak, set to work to rebuild the house of God. Now, let me just explain this. When the children of God, when they stopped building, and for a long time they stayed, and there was quietness, and there was nothing that they do. You know, the enemy, when the enemy comes, the reason why what he wants to do is to stop your progression. Praise the name of the Lord. The moment that you lose vision, the moment that you get distracted, and the moment that you fall away from the things of God, you start doing the things that you're not supposed to do. And I started researching and wondering, what was this message that Haggai the prophet brought to the children of Israel that they had and quickened them even to get into the working of building up the temple? Realize that they did not stop for one day. They did not stop for 2 days, but they stopped for so long, you know, to a point where they actually forgot their purpose of getting, of building. And, you know, that reminds me that, you know, there could be a prophetic word that was given to you, even when you're coming to this nation, or something that God told you to do. And it has taken so long, and there's been so much discouragement, and there's been so many things that have come, and so many attacks, that even you've forgotten what the Lord has told you to do. And because of the warfare, and maybe it could not even be the warfare, could be that you got to a state of complacency, getting into a state of compromise, getting to a state where, you know, you get so, like, let me just give an example, like coming to this nation, we get to a place of being too comfortable, praise the name of the Lord, and we forget our purpose. And you know, when we see, and this is exactly what happened to the children of Israel. And I just want to take you to the book of Haggai, because in Haggai, I didn't even know that there was a relationship between the book of Haggai and Ezra itself. And the message that Haggai brought to the children of Israel is actually this message. It is in the book of Haggai, chapter 1. Praise the name of the Lord. So if we go to the book of Haggai, chapter 1, the Bible says, actually chapter 2, it says, Haggai 1 verse 2, it says, this is what the Lord Almighty says. Actually, let me start from the beginning, because you'll see it is the same prophets that came to the children of Israel after they had ceased from doing what they were supposed to do, after they had gotten discouragement. And just if you, and just look at the difference between the book of Ezra and the children and the book of Nehemiah. In the book of Nehemiah, despite the taunting of the enemy, despite the discouragement from the enemy, despite the opposition that they were getting that was so great, and we see that there was so much opposition also from within, from without, from the Jews themselves, we do not see a point where they got so discouraged that they stopped working. In fact, in the book of Nehemiah, the Bible says that when the attack got too much, they started realigning themselves. They started getting into a position of battle. And we see to the point of where they were walking with all their weapons with them. We see to a point where they were actually even putting watchmen on the wall to check and see they were walking. Everybody was alert. Everybody was aware until they finished the work of God. But we see in the book of Ezra, there was a stopping of the work of God. In the book of Ezra, we see a moment where for a long time, the work of God seemed to be like it had ended. It looked like the prophecy had been, that the enemy had sabotaged the plan and the purposes of God. It looked like the enemy had come in and had obstructed the children of their vision. Praise the name of the Lord. And the Bible, and God, who does not give up on us. It doesn't matter how far we have gone. It doesn't matter how discouraged we are. God will always come back to us. He will always come back to remind us and to tell us, hey, what is going on here? Hey, remember what I spoke to you. God is a God of mercy. God is a God of compassion. And his word, the Bible says that when the word of God goes forth, it does not go back to him void. It accomplishes his purpose. It accomplishes what he sent it to do. And the Bible says that not only does it accomplish, but it is fruitful. Praise the name of the Lord. It is fruitful in the assignment. And no matter how long it takes, the word of God is sharper than any two-edged sword. It will not return to God. It has to achieve its purposes. And so in Haggai chapter 1, the Bible says that in the second year of King Darius, on the first day of the sixth month, the word of the Lord came from the prophet Haggai to Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, governor of Judah, and to Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest. And this is what the Lord Almighty said. These people say, the time has not yet come to rebuild the Lord's house. Do you see how it starts? It means that when everything was put on hold, the children of Israel became complacent. The children of Israel forgot their purpose. Praise the name of the Lord. They forgot their calling. And the Lord comes to start them afresh. And it's like he tells them, these people think that it is not time to rebuild the Lord's house. Then the word of God says in 3, it says, then the word of the Lord came through the prophet Haggai. Is it time for you to for yourself to be living in your paneled houses? Well, this house remains in ruins. That means that the children of Israel, their purpose, their vision, it got distracted. Instead of building the house of God, they started, because of what they had gone through, they stopped. And instead, they started focusing on building their own houses. Instead of putting things in order, they got distracted and doing the things that they were not supposed to be doing. Praise the name of the Lord. The first thing they were supposed to do was to make sure that the house of God was put into place, that worship was restored before they themselves could build their own houses. And in verse 5, it says, now this is what the Lord Almighty says. I'm in the book of Haggai. Give careful thought to your ways. You planted much, but harvested little. You eat, but never have enough. You drink, but never have your fill. You put on clothes, but are not warm. You earn wages, only to put them in a pass with walls, meaning already they were experiencing contrary to what they were not experiencing the blessings of God because they were not doing the will of God. Whenever we don't walk in the will of God, whenever we do, we get distracted and we do our own thing, then we keep ourselves from receiving the blessing of God. And this is what exactly happened. And we see God commanding them in 7, be careful, telling them to take thought of the things of their ways, and then telling them to go up into the mountain, to bring down the timber, and to build the house. Meaning that God, when God was telling them to rebuild the house, he knew that the people, that the enemy was still there. God did not come to speak to them because the enemy had stopped up, because the enemy's power had ceased. God did not tell them to continue. Because everything, you know, because the enemy was not going to come to come after them. But God was telling them, arise, build, despite their position, there will still be a position, but you have to keep on building. You have to do my will. And the Bible says that the Bible says, and I thank God, because I'm just going to jump. He says, because my house remains in ruins. And then the Bible says in verse 12, and that is where we come in the book of Ezra. It says, then Zerubbabel, son of Shealtiel, Joshua, son of Jozadak, the high priest, and the whole remnant of the people obeyed the voice of the Lord their God and the message of the prophet Haggai, because the Lord their God had sent him, and the people feared the Lord. Praise the name of the Lord. The people feared the Lord. And then I love this, the message that the Lord said in verse 13 of Haggai. It says, the Lord promised them, I am with you. I am with you. So he stirred up the spirit of the Zerubbabel, son of Jozadak. He stirred up the high priest. He stirred up the whole remnant of the people. And the Bible says they came and they began to work on the house of the Lord Almighty on the 24th day of the sixth month. So we see that the people are stirred back afresh into the work of God. But realize what can happen if you stop doing the will of God. You will get distracted. They lost the blessings of God. They became so complacent. They were way away from the will of God. They started doing their own thing, praise the name of the Lord, thinking that everything was in order. Because as they were building the houses, maybe they were flourishing, they were doing their businesses, but they were not getting the returns from their businesses. They were trying to build up the city in their own ways, but everything was not coming back to order because they had come out of the order of God. May the Lord realign us in accordance to his purpose. May the Lord bring us back in the name of Jesus. May our first purpose be to bring up, to build our altar. May we come back to building our altar. May we come back to building the age-old foundations, putting things back in order, bringing godliness into our homes, bringing, you know, honoring God in everything that we do. Praise the name of the Lord. That is what God wants us to do, putting him foremost above everything else. You know, instead of trying to do our own things, and we miss out on the best that God has for us. Praise the name of the Lord. I don't know what time it is. Praise the Lord. I'm just going to go real quickly. And the Bible says, if I can go real quick, praise the name of the Lord. I have so many. If we can just jump to Ezra chapter 6, praise the name of the Lord. Actually, not Ezra chapter 6, but it says, in Ezra chapter 5, verse 3, if I don't finish, then maybe Pastor will finish it, or we can do that later. But the Bible says in Ezra chapter 5, verse 3, it says that at that time, Tattenai, governor of the Trans-Euphrates, and Shida and Bozenai and their associates, they went to them, realized that now they had come back, and they started building on the house of the, they came back to their senses and they started rebuilding. And the Bible says that their enemies saw what was going on, realized that they were quiet. And all of a sudden they see that the building is starting to be rebuilt. And they know that there was a king who had said, this thing should not be rebuilt until I say. And the Bible says that they came in verse 4 and they asked, what are the names? And they asked him, verse 3, it says, who authorized you to rebuild this temple and to finish it? This is what they come and ask. Who authorized you to rebuild this temple and to finish it? while the people were building their houses, when they were running their businesses, when they were doing what was good in their own eyes, nobody came against them. But the moment that they start rebuilding again, the enemy rises up and he says, who told you? Who authorized you to rebuild this temple? Who authorized you to finish it? They even started asking, what are the names of those that are constructing this building? And the Bible says, I love what it says in verse 5. It says, but the eye of their God was watching over the elders of the Jews, and they were not stopped until a report could go to Darius and his written reply be received. So God, you remember what God said in the book of Haggai? He told them, I'm going to be with you. Build. I'm going to be with you. God will come to encourage you at all times, from wherever, from the place where you are. And he will tell you, build. Come on, I'm with you. I will not leave you. I will not forsake you. And the Bible says that God stepped in. Immediately the enemy stepped in. God also stepped in. And the Bible says that the eye of the Lord, your God, was watching over the elders of the Jews, and they were not stopped until a report could go to Darius and his written reply be received. And when the written reply of Darius comes, this is when we see that everything is changed, and we see a change and a transformation, and we see God acting and God fighting for them. Praise the name of the Lord. And what I'm going to do, because of the time, I'm going to stop there, and we shall continue and see what God has for us. So praise the name of the Lord. Let us continue building. It doesn't matter the opposition that you get. Let us not forget what God has called us to. Let us not forget that God brought us into this country, that God has called us to fulfill his purposes. Sometimes you look at ourselves and you see that, God, maybe I've just been called to do this little thing, this thing. You know, whatever God has put in your heart to do, do it with all your heart. Because if you don't, then you're going to miss out on the blessings of God. Opposition will come, but like the children in the book of Nehemiah, let us stand strong. Let us fight the battles. Let us know that God is on our side. He will never leave us. He will not forsake us. He will come to our aid, and he will come through for us. So may the Lord bless you, and may the Lord do you good. I'm going to hand it over to Pastor.